In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful.
My journey to Islam started when a couple of friends of mine, they wanted to take me to the mosque. I was hanging out with a lot of people that were Muslim. They didn't behave as Muslims, but they were Muslim. So the first initial group. And then, alhamdulillah, I met a sister that is still very near and dear to me. And she actually took me to the masjid, alhamdulillah. But it all started, me wanting to go to the masjid came from me wanting something better for my kids. I was looking for something better for my kids because my life was very disorganized. You know, I come from a household where my mother was a drug addict. My father was a cartel. He was in the Colombian cartel. He got 30 years in jail. My mother died from a heroin overdose. So my lifestyle was very similar to them. And I was going down that path. And I didn't want to leave my kids the way my mother left us. So the more I reflected on that, that kind of pushed me to look for something, like, you know, for something. And when I was hanging out with them, they told me that being Muslim was about just believing in one God. And that was appeasing to me. You know, I didn't have to have any statues. And it's just one God. And I got curious. That's where it started. The rest of my family did not react in a positive way to me being Muslim. It wasn't so much me saying la ilaha illallah that bothered them, because they're not Catholic to the sense where they're constantly in the church, or, you know, they just go to church when it's the palms or the ashes. But it was my attire that disturbed them, and the things that I changed. I no longer was Natalie that came in with the coronas and was like, hey, party over here, you know. I was now Natalie, who was like, assalamu alaikum, how are you? And they're like, they didn't understand when I didn't want to go to a barbecue because they had pork. They didn't understand when I didn't want to go because they were drinking. They didn't understand that I didn't celebrate birthdays and that I wasn't going to celebrate a birthday. So, and they didn't understand how a person that was so fond of her 6-inch heels and her little dresses and her hair, I'm talking about extensions, eyelashes, nails, everything. They didn't understand how a person like that can turn into this. So they didn't recognize. One Christmas, I went to visit them, and they literally slammed the door in my face. They didn't recognize who I was. My cousin looked at me and was like, what the heck? So they didn't have a good reaction at first. But alhamdulillah, with time, they came to accept it. It's just something you have to push through. You have to push through it, and eventually, if you hold on to it hard enough, they'll accept it. You know, I compared my dress attire to that of the Virgin Mary. I'm like, how do you pray to her and it's okay for her to dress like that? This is supposed to be the person that you think is the greatest woman on earth, you know, and you don't want me to dress like her. And that kind of shut them up. And then after reflecting, I guess, for a while, they realized, they're like, well, you know what, if this means you're not leaving the house drunk, and they're not calling us to tell us you drove yourself into a tree or that you're high or whatever, then we like you like this. So they don't like it. So one of my sisters doesn't speak to me to this day, but alhamdulillah, they accept it. My first Ramadan was extremely difficult for me. Extremely difficult because I had not that, I was new to Islam. I didn't have that many sisters in Islam. And, well, not, I had a lot of sisters, but I didn't know a lot of sisters, like to go to iftars and this and that. And it was my first year wearing hijab. It was in the summer. It was extremely long hours. I was also, I come from a family where food is like, you know, we make huge meals all the time, and I had to cook for the kids. It was very difficult. But alhamdulillah, like, it's when the thirst was the biggest deal. But once you push through it, and it just becomes, you know, it becomes easier. But the good thing is that the satisfaction you get when you do break your fast, of knowing that you accomplished it, and, you know, being there, what helped me was when I started to get with the sisters, you know, surround myself with these sisters. And, like, the bond you create with these sisters, that helped a lot too. calling each other, how are you doing? How's it going? I'm thirsty. The one thing I love about Islam is I love my sisters in Islam. And I also love the promise of something better at the end. Because nobody wants to do this forever, right? I love my sisters in Islam because they're closer to me than my blood sisters, always. Even before I was Muslim, the relationship that I had with my sisters, I can never compare to the relationships I have with my sisters in Islam. And I can say that that's for every single Muslim woman I know, revert, non-revert, like sisters in Islam, we're just, you know, it's not like the friends I had at the bar that you go there and, you know, you're friends while you're getting drunk and you're only there to hold each other's hair if you're throwing up. You know, these sisters, you know, they're there in the good, the bad, the pretty, the ugly, everything. You know, these sisters, even though they're not blood related to me, they're closer to my children than my family. They're closer to me than my family. So alhamdulillah, my favorite part is definitely my sisters in Islam.
Pertanyaannya, kenapa sih sekarang umat Islam di mana-mana kok banyak puji-puji orang kafir, mau dukung orang kafir? Saudara, banyak orang awam ini hanya menjadi korban penyesatan opini, korban media. Kesian, mereka nggak ngerti berita yang sebenarnya, saudara. Nah, karena itu saya ajak semua umat Islam yang ada di sini, tolong yuk rame-rame kita menjadi laskar cyber. Laskar cyber ini luar biasa, saudara. Berkah dari Allah. Sejak aksi 411 sampai 212, tanpa dikomando, tanpa ada pendaftaran, tanpa ada gaji, tanpa punya kantor, saudara, umat Islam di mana-mana bergabung menjadi, yaitu satu kekuatan yang luar biasa, menjadi Muslim Cyber Army, yaitu menjadi laskar cyber Muslim. Apa tugas mereka? Saudara, setiap ada situs yang menghina Islam, mereka serang. Setiap ada berita hoax yang mempermalukan para tokoh Islam, mereka serang. Setiap ada gerakan musuh, saudara, yang ingin mecah belah umat, mereka serang. Dan udah banyak situs-situs akun-akun musuh-musuh Islam yang bertumbangan satu persatu, saudara. Alhamdulillah. Saya kasih contoh. Kemarin setelah kejadian di Polda Jabar, website akun daripada akun resmi Humas Polda Jabar bikin berita hoax. Apa bunyi beritanya? Beritanya ingin mengadu domba. Di situ ditulis PW Muhammadiyah Saudara Bandung mengecam FPI. Nah, bunyi beritanya begitu. Ini akun resmi Humas Polda Jabar. Subhanallah, warga Muhammadiyah baca itu, saudara. Lapor ke pimpinan. Pimpinan Muhammadiyah enggak terima di Bandung, saudara. Gelar siaran pers. Mereka katakan, kami tidak pernah memberikan pernyataan semacam itu. Kami tidak pernah mengecam FPI. Bahkan kami Muhammadiyah di Jawa Barat mendukung perjuangan FPI dalam amar ma'ruf nahi munkar. Takbir.
Allahu Akbar.
Begitu Muhammadiyah mengklarifikasi, saudara, akhirnya laskar cyber rame-rame menyerbu di medsos, yaitu akun resmi daripada Humas Polda Jabar, saudara. Karang kabut, gulung tikar, dia gembok, gak berani buka lagi, saudara. Alhamdulillah. Nah, berarti saya tanya, kalau begitu laskar cyber itu penting tidak? Perlu tidak? Nah, itu salah satu cara untuk menyadarkan masyarakat. Jadi mereka akan memberitakan kebohongan-kebohongan, fitnah-fitnah. Kita lawan dengan berita yang benar, kita lawan dengan kejujuran. Jadi jangan bohong dilawan bohong, jangan fitnah dilawan fitnah. Fitnah, kebohongan, kita lawan dengan kejujuran dan kebenaran. Nah, insya Allah gerakan ini akan menjadi satu gerakan yang kuat, yang akan mampu untuk menghancurkan mereka. Satu lagi saya kasih contoh. Ahok pada saat pertama kali di sidang, saudara, dia sudah setel ini media cetak dan elektronik. Dia sudah setel tukang-tukang fotonya untuk di medsos. Apa yang dilakukan? Ada drama air mata. Dia nangis, saudara. Itu begitu dia nangis, saudara, itu fotonya langsung menyebar, yaitu di medsos, saudara. untuk menarik simpatik masyarakat. Kesian orang ini zalimi, orang ini dianiaya, orang ini sudah minta maaf, orang sudah menyadari kesalahannya, kenapa harus diperlakukan seperti ini dan seterusnya sudah.
Itu
yang bergerak, medsos mereka.
Sampai ke HP Habib juga.
Ya, ini cyber semua sudah bergerak. Tapi yang menarik, tidak sampai 30 menit, saudara, ini laskar cyber masuk ke dalam dunia medsos. Satu, mereka bikin meme, ada buaya lagi nangis. Satu, ada lagi yang bikin meme, foto orang yang pernah digusur sama Ahok nangis-nangis sudah. Ditampilkan, ada filmnya sudah, kemudian ditulis, dulu ada nenek-nenek nangis di hadapanmu. Kau caci-maki dia dengan tangisannya, sekarang kau nangis. Akhirnya dalam setengah jam hancur lebur, bukan dapat simpatik, dapat caci-maki dibuli sudah. Maka itu saya tanya sekali lagi, kalau gitu laskar cyber penting tidak? Perlu tidak? Siap jadi laskar cyber?
Siap.
Takbir.
Allah.